This sounds a lot like the difference between autism and not autism spectrum. Is on that on the autism spectrum, typically there's too many senses coming in. It's sensory overload. Is that more or less the moral of the story?
That's part of the moral of the story, is that in some sense we need to do things on the cheap, and so we the senses really have to filter things out and ignore a lot of stuff. And so in some sense you're ignoring a lot of the truth just because it's too complicated. And that was sort of the intuition that sort of was guiding me to begin with. But it turns out that even though that's true and important, there's a much deeper aspect to it, and that is that selection pressures are only towards sensory systems that are tuned to the fitness payoffs, the things that will think of it as a big video game, and you're running around trying to grab points in the video game. If you get enough points, you get to the next level. Well, in evolutionary theory, in some sense, you know, if you eat an apple, you get certain fitness payoffs. If you fall off a cliff, you know, you have negative fitness consequences. And so think about, you're going through life and you're getting all these fitness payoffs. And so if you're doing anything in a video game except going for the points, you're not going to get to the next level. You have to really focus on grabbing points to get to the next level. And the same thing, it turns out, in evolution. If your senses are doing anything but trying to get fitness payoffs, then you are going to be less fit. And then the weird thing is that almost surely fitness payoffs do not tell you anything about the structure of the world. So to the extent that your perceptual systems are tuning you to discriminate, this is high fitness payoff, low fitness payoff, this is bad, this is good in terms of fitness, it will not be telling you anything about truth, because fitness payoffs are they don't preserve the structure of the true structure of the world. And so we're able to prove that in two different ways. That idea and a different idea, that just the optimal inference strategy that would come out of a natural selection also doesn't bias you towards seeing the truth. So it was, I came off thinking about it that it was just going to be too expensive and too time consuming to see the truth. But then I found out, no, selection pressures are uniformly against seeing any aspect of the truth, which was quite surprising. And so we've published that result and had lots of feedback from, you know, my colleagues in cognitive neurosciences and philosophy. And so the question then that naturally comes up is, so if our sensory systems, if our eyes, for example, are not telling us the truth about the world, then what good are they? How could they possibly be useful if they're not telling us the truth? And I have a metaphor that I think is very, very helpful in this, and it's what I call the desktop metaphor. And if you're say using a paint program on your computer, like Adobe Illustrator or something like that, and you have a paintbrush icon that you're using to paint some color into a region of your artwork, does that paintbrush icon on your screen mean that inside your computer there's a paintbrush that looks just like that paintbrush icon on your screen? Well, of course not. And if the paintbrush icon is in the middle of your screen, does that mean that there's a paintbrush in the middle of your computer? Well, of course not. And anybody who thought that misunderstands the point of the interface. The interface is not there to show you the reality of the computer, the diodes, the resistors, the voltages, and magnetic fields. It's there, in fact, to hide the truth of the computer, all that complexity, and to just give you simple eye candy, tools that let you accomplish certain tasks, that let you control the computer, even though you're completely ignorant about what's really going on inside the computer. And so that's what evolution has done for us. It has given us sensory systems that are like a desktop user interface. So space and time as you perceive them, are your desktop. And physical objects like, you know, apples and trees and forks and spoons, these things are just icons in your desktop. And evolution shaped us with space and time, perceptions of space and time and physical objects, not to show us the truth, but explicitly to hide the truth, because we don't need to know the truth.
Horse blinders.
Exactly right. Horse blinders, and yet this, what we do see, allows us to control objective reality, whatever it might be, while we're completely ignorant about the nature of objective reality. That seems to be the way I'll put it this way: if our senses evolved and were shaped by natural selection, then the probability is zero that the predicates of space-time, matter, physical objects, shapes in space-time, are the right predicates or the right language to describe objective reality. The probability is zero that you could even phrase a true description of objective reality using the language of space and time and matter and objects and so forth. And so evolution shaped us with a language that's designed to keep us alive, and that language just doesn't have the right tools to talk about objective reality, at least the perceptual language. It would be like this: if I said, I want you to, so I have a computer science class I'm teaching, say, and I tell the students, I want you to give me a paper that describes how the CPU of a computer works, but the only language you can use is the language of pixels on your desktop. That's the only language you can use. Well, good luck. That's the wrong language to describe a CPU. And that's what we're stuck with. If we try to describe objective reality using the language of space and time and physical objects, we're stuck with the wrong language. We can't do it. And so every metaphor has its strengths and weaknesses. One strength of this metaphor is that it helps us to understand how, even if our senses aren't showing us the truth, they could still be helpful. If I'm writing an email and the icon for the email is blue and rectangular in the middle of the screen, I'm not fooled into thinking that the email is blue and rectangular, and yet that, or in the middle of a computer. But that blue icon is very, very helpful to me. It helps me open the email. It helps me copy it or delete it if I want to, and so forth. So it gives me an ability to control reality, even though I don't know what reality is. So that's the upside of the metaphor. The downside is most of the icons and desktop interfaces that we use right now are two-dimensional. And the icons that we have are not that complicated, and they don't have a lot of different functions. But I think that downside of the metaphor will disappear in a few years, very few years, when we have 3D holographic desktops, and the icons are real three-dimensional objects that we can manipulate, and they have all sorts of new possibilities for interaction. Then this metaphor of the desktop and icons, with the richer kind of three-dimensional icons, will be a much better metaphor for what evolution has done for us.